class, please take your seats. Now, your instructor, Vincent Finelli.
Everyone all set and cocked, locked. Here we go. I'm Vincent Finelli. Captain John Regan is with us. Welcome, Captain John Regan.
Good morning, Vincent.
John, I'm so glad you're here today with me to discuss a most important topic. For the next 2 hours, it's Fukushima 106 and 107 in the series. And we thought it would be maybe Fukushima 101 and that would be it, or maybe 101 and 102. Then it was 103 and 104 and 105. And now it's 106 and 107.
And I still have 80 links beyond what's posted.
Yeah, I really appreciate your research, and I've gotten a number of compliments on your work, I can't thank you enough. It's a serious topic. We're talking about the pollution of the planet. Dr. Richard Allen Miller said this may be an extinction event. People are asking, you know, where are the fish in the Pacific? People aren't feeling well. I cannot tell you how many telephone calls I get. And no one calls me and says, I feel great. Nobody does that. They're tired. They're worn out. They're lethargic. They're saying, they're even saying that their animals are lethargic. Their dogs and their cats just don't seem to have the energy, the get up and go that they used to have. It's like their get up and go got up and left. I'm not exaggerating. John, for one time, just one time, yesterday I looked up at the sky and I saw the most unusual thing. And the reason I looked up at the sky is I heard the sound of a jet, a large jet flying overhead. You could hear the sound of the engines roaring. There was no chemtrail behind this jet. There was no chemtrail. There was no contrail. It was just the jet. It was even hard to spot because all I could do was hear the sound and not see anything except the speck of what was a jet aircraft. So for once, no chemtrails in the sky from this one particular jet. And of course, this morning they fired right up again and they're spraying chemtrails all over us. We're getting calls from people who are sick. And we believe that our animals are sick. We believe that the trees are dying. And we believe that the hoses are failing. And a lot of this is related to the radiation poisoning of the planet from Fukushima and the nuclear reactors that were put in the wrong spot. Not that we recommend nuclear power generation. I don't recommend it at all. I'm not a supporter of it. I think it's insanity. And so does Dr. Shealy. And so does Dr. Richard Allen Miller. They both believe that too. I believe you and I are on the same page as well, right?
Right.
Okay. So I'm at thefinancialstateoftheunion.com. Thefinancialstateoftheunion.com. I've clicked on the news tab, and there is a series of links that you have called, well, there's a Tale of Two Droughts section, the Fukushima section, Tritium section, From the Vault section, the financial section, the employment section, spy tech and control health, and bigger picture and government smarts. Those are all sections within this tab called the News tab. And there's a new News tab every week that John posts, Captain John Regan, at thefinancialstateoftheunion.com for our reading pleasure. Well, maybe it's not reading pleasure. it might for those who need a jump start of their hearts, this might do it. Captain John Reagan's with us, and we're talking about Fukushima, and this is the Fukushima 106, followed next hour by 107. Okay, John, we're ready.
And unfortunately, it's going to be a little bit beyond Fukushima. We'll also be talking a bit about St. Louis as well. Mm-hmm. First up, I included the link that you had on your website on the Wigner effect. And I did that for a reason, because I'm working on a place where I can put these reports so that they're easily accessible, along with links to the archives, so that people that get in the game late can easily go back and get information. Mm-hmm. I also included the radiation this week from Veterans Today. this week there were 31 cities that had 1,000 counts per minute or more. The winner is Colorado Springs, Colorado, at 1,747 counts per minute, nearly 350 times normal. And I was listening to the third hour from Jeff Rentz last night, which is his weekly Fukushima update, and had Yoichi Shimatsu on there. He was formerly the editor of the Japan Times Weekly, so he's a established, respectable journalist out of Japan that's doing his best to report what's going on. And he happens to be in the United States right now, and he was flying over the Rockies, and he has a microsievert detector with him. And you want to see a reading of below 0.1 on that. Ideally, you'd like to see 0.00. And flying over the Rockies, he was getting readings of like 3.1, 3.2. Just outrageous amounts of radiation in our atmosphere. And you can, if you look through the list on Veterans Today, it's basically all across the country: Arizona, Florida, Arkansas, Texas, Idaho, California, North Carolina, Washington, South Dakota, Maine, Oklahoma, Nebraska, Florida, Massachusetts, Kentucky, Kansas, and even in the district criminals, the high reading was 401 counts per minute, 80 times normal. So it's out there, and it's not going away. The third link under there, radiation exposure. This is about radiation that people receive from tests when they go in to get heart tests, and they're getting basically a 20% higher radiation dose because the facilities in the United States aren't following the radiation dosing guidelines. And keep in mind, this is kind of the good radiation that's only exposure, not the really bad stuff where you've taken the radiation internally. And that leads me into LNT model tested. That is the linear no threshold risk model. It's a technical term basically saying for ionizing radiation, there's a linear relationship. You draw a line, starting from zero, where you got zero radiation, and as the radiation increases, the line goes up, basically in a linear, unlike the exponential that we tend to see with things like our national debt nowadays. And this guy went into a medical library, pulled out studies, and compared this model versus the other theories of one is you've got a safe amount of radiation up to a point that doesn't really increase cancer. And these are solid cancers that they're talking about here, tumors. And once you reach that threshold, then it goes up in a linear fashion. There's also another theory that says that there's a certain amount of radiation that's actually good for you, and then once you get beyond that point, it increases in a linear fashion. and he pulled out the studies and compared the models, and it turns out that this linear model, where there's not a threshold, as soon as you get radiation, even small amounts, it starts increasing your risk, it is the closest fit. And they also, he separated out studies that were done on children, worked out the same way. Then he overlaid a study that he had found on childhood leukemia. And at very low levels, this had an exponential upward risk. So, it's difficult to describe in the charts. So there's a video on that link. It's about 9 minutes that it's fairly easy to understand. So, whereas this risk of solid tumor cancer goes up in a linear fashion for the dosage, for children, that leukemia risk just skyrockets to where at these low doses, you're already at the risk level that you would have been at with the larger end of the study for the solid cancer. I found that a bit disturbing. And again, these dosages, from what I can tell, is the exposure to radiation and not the ingestion of radiation. I don't know if you wanted to comment on that.
John, I've been in touch with a number of people over the last couple of weeks, and I'm hearing more about brain tumors. I'm hearing more about cancers than ever before. And although the sample is small, it seems like, how can there be so much cancer, and how can there be so many brain issues? How can there be so many brain tumors? And I don't think it's just people. I think it's our animals too. I think our animals are suffering from cancers as well. When I feel the coat and hug one of my my dogs here at the farm, I can feel these tumors under the coat. You can feel these bumps. And so here's the homework for all of our class. If you have some cats, you have dogs, why don't you feel their coats and see if you feel the same kind of bumps that I feel, and let us know. Let us know if it's just me. And do you have, just think about the people whom you know and you've been in contact with over the marketing season. Did you hear of more injuries, more brain type problems? Tomorrow, I believe, we're going to get a call with Dr. Norman Shealy about Parkinson's disease. A friend of mine who I've been friends with since the 70s. And, I just found out that I haven't seen her in decades, but I heard that she has Parkinson's. Where's that come from? So she may be calling in tomorrow to discuss this with Dr. Shealy. I hope she does. And you'll hear the rest of the story tomorrow. John, there's so much sickness, I can't believe it. I got a message from one of our children that one of my dear friends was in the hospital. He's suffering from a case of amnesia. He's hospitalized for it. Amnesia. And he can't remember, and all of a sudden he just kind of blacks out. These things are happening all around us. And one of the things that you and I do is bring anecdotal evidence to the airwaves. We talk about things that are happening to us, and what happens is those who listen to us go, wow, so it's not just me. It's a bunch of us that are experiencing this, so I'm very concerned. So that's my comment.
Next up, I have a link called Salt or Not, the headline of the article is nuclear waste storage sites and rock salt may be more vulnerable than previously thought. And it turns out, this is research through the University of Texas at Austin, that rock salt used by Germany and the United States for subsurface containment of radioactive waste may not be as impermeable as thought and as capable of releasing the nuclear waste into the environment.
I've got a comment on that when we come back, John. I actually have a bill that should be put before Congress. I'm sorry. A bill that should be put before our state legislatures that will stop this nonsense. It's just one sentence. It'll fix the whole problem. We'll be right back. John, you're talking about disposing of nuclear or hazardous waste, and you know, we really don't have a solution. And so if we are putting containers of radioactive waste in an environment that's surrounded by salt, salt is water soluble, okay? And it rusts most metal containers. It's as simple as that. And so here's my solution. It's a one sentence bill that will solve all of our, well, almost all of our problems with Washington, D.C. Here it is. And if this were, this bill, this one sentence bill were passed into law by all the states, our problems would be all but gone. Here it is. No trash, garbage, or waste of any kind shall cross state, Commonwealth, or District of Columbia lines. Let me say that again. No trash, garbage, or waste of any kind shall cross state, Commonwealth, or District of Columbia lines. That means that if you have garbage in your state, household garbage, steel cans, aluminum cans, radioactive waste, liquid waste, effluent, solid waste from septic systems, whatever it is, it cannot cross state lines. So if every state made that law, Washington, D.C. would be buried in its own trash. They'd have buildings taller than skyscrapers with trash. They could not survive. That one sentence would solve most of our problems. This hazardous waste that we've created, we've done this. We have done this. General Electric and companies like that, DuPont, have created hazardous waste for which there is no way of, and we can call it disposing of it, but it's just putting it someplace, which is a ticking time bomb for later contamination and destruction. Let's see, we've got Michael in New York. Welcome.
Yeah, I just wanted to comment on your going over the dogs or with your with the bumps on them. Yeah, it's kind of in the last few years gotten really out of hand. From a lot of people I've spoken with, I mean, at a local park we go to here, a lot of people have. I mean, we got a dog, he just turned 4, and he had a tumor that had to be removed, which was cancerous, and he's also got these other lumps, which they say could be cysts or whatever, but either way, it's phenomenal how many people we talked to at the park were so many of them, especially the purebreds, maybe not so much the mutts, but I noticed in talking to the breeder that we got ours from, I noticed that one of the big differences that, because prior to this one, the dog we had from the same people lived to around 11 or more. And this one, you know, 3 years old and he has a tumor, but I also learned that both of them, unlike the first breeding we had, both of the dogs have also had RFID chips in there too. So, and according to the breeder, the mother of the dog we had had a tumor removed from the breast. So it's, you know, between the fact that they get a ton of vaccines, between the chips that are in there now, it just seems like it's gotten way out of hand from people I've spoken with, where dogs that normally are there, you know, 11, 12 years old are getting these things at 2 and 3.
That's exactly my point, Mike. Exactly my point, and I'm so glad you mentioned it. Could you hold on through the break? I've got a couple quick questions for you.
Sure.
John Regan and I will be right back. Fukushima, and that's the topic today. And I'm Vin Finelli. This is USAPrepares.com. Very serious broadcast, and you can tell by the tone in our voices. Everyone all set, cocked, locked, hour number two of USAPrepares.com. And this is Fukushima 107. During the top of the hour news, John Regan and I were on the on a call with our previous caller, Mike from New York, and he had mentioned that he has been seeing the same kind of things that I mentioned here on USA Prepares Hour Number One, and that is the problems that the dogs and are having here at the farm, our dogs. And he mentioned, and he, by the way, he's going to be on with us tomorrow. He's going to call in and share these experiences in detail with Dr. Norman Shealy in our class. That'll be tomorrow during the broadcast. And he said that he's had golden retrievers that have lived a long time, and now it seems that they get sick earlier. A boxer, 1.5 to 2 years old, had some serious problems. And there seems to be a correlation between the RFID chipping, the vaccines, the dog food, the radiation, the chemical spraying, and I believe electromagnetic radiation. I think these things are showing up in animals and plants, trees, and I'm seeing it here on the farm. I'm collecting more dead wood than I've ever collected. Trees are dying and falling over. We're using them as firewood, but why are they dying? And just look around in your neighborhood. Are you seeing the same evidence of trees dying that we're seeing? So I think that we are poisoning the planet. We're sicker than ever. And that's why we're talking about Fukushima, which is releasing poison, deadly poison, into the air, into the water, into the food supply, into the oceans of the entire world. And it's not just Fukushima. It's the atomic testing, the nuclear testing that our country's been involved in, other countries have been involved in. It's absolute insanity. I believe Captain John Regan agrees with me completely on this point. Captain John?
Yes, and let me just back up a minute why we're here. On December 14th, I had an article I reported on that there was a recently declassified U.S. government report, and this is low-level classification for official use only, from March 18th, 2011, 1 week after the initial event. And in this report, it stated that 100% of spent fuel pool 4, 50% of pool 3, and 25% of pool 2, that radiation had all been released to the atmosphere. And just to point out how bad that is, let me go down to the first article from the vault entitled Fuel, March 2011. There was a report that TEPCO had done saying that it had a total of 1,760 metric tons of fresh and used nuclear fuel on site last year. The reactor 3, which was the MOX mixed fuel reactor with plutonium, had about 90 tons of fuel. The pool above reactor 4, now reactor 4 was shut down at the time, had 135 metric tons. And to put that in perspective, the Three Mile Island event in 79 was about 30 tons, and the Chernobyl reactors had about 180 tons when the accident occurred in 1986. However, oh boy, you think it can't get worse. They had transferred more radioactive spent fuel into the storage pools before the event. So at the time of the earthquake and tsunami, 3,400 tons of fuel in 7 spent fuel pools, plus 877 tons of active fuel in the cores of the reactors, totaling 4,277 tons of nuclear fuel at Fukushima, which puts it at about 24 times the amount of fuel that Chernobyl had. So not only, you look at it and think, well, there was 3 reactors involved, that's 3 times Chernobyl. No, the amount of fuel involved is 24 times Chernobyl. And we discovered that a bunch of that went into the air, and that's why we're here on the air talking about it.
And I, at the risk of being repetitive, I mentioned many times on this broadcast that I have an article that shows in Parade magazine that shows an 8-legged horse being born downwind from Chernobyl. And I viewed a television report about 10 years after the Three Mile Island nuclear meltdown in Pennsylvania, where every family in this neighborhood had some kind of cancer. And this man showed a dandelion leaf on his front lawn, and he stretched it out on camera, on television. And this dandelion leaf stretched from his fingertips to his shoulder, about 3 feet long. So if you think that these things are imaginary, I've seen them. I've seen the stories. I've read the stories. And that's why I'm so concerned. Bill in New York, you're on with Captain John Regan and me. Welcome.
Yes, go ahead. I wanted to share some information. I have a unique situation. I spent 25 years repairing x-ray machines. And 10 years ago, I was diagnosed with CML, which is a leukemia that's very common among people that are exposed to radiation. And the interesting thing that I wanted to share is when I got it 10 years ago, they had just come out with a medication that has kept me alive for 10 years. I've since removed myself from all fields, electromagnetic, x-ray, any kind of field. But what I find interesting that I want to share with you guys is that about 4 years ago, I started noticing that there's about 7 or 8 drugs that they've come out with for leukemia. And I stopped and I thought, why would they do that? The percentage of people 10 years ago that had leukemia in the country had to be less than 1%. And I thought, why would they spend all this money researching? And then you guys have kind of filled in some of the gaps. And I feel like maybe they know that the radiation levels are wicked high and that, boy, leukemia medication is going to be a lucrative business in the next 10, 15, 20 years.
Very, very interesting point. And that's one of the things that happens here at USA Prepares. We are connecting the dots. And what you said, Bill, is absolutely brilliant. Talking about the number of leukemia drugs that are appearing. I remember when I was in elementary school, there was one person who died of leukemia in 8th grade. And it was an absolute shock to the whole area. You know, those, and because it was so rare, and how could this young person get it and die from it? I mean, and now there's, you know, there's plenty of leukemia to go around. May I ask a favor of you? Would you mind? Yes. Would you mind calling in tomorrow? Dr. Norman Shealy is going to be on, and I think that this is something that would be very important to share with our broadcast classroom with Dr. Norman Shealy and you, because he is he's expert in electromagnetic radiation, electric fields, and he experiments with it a lot and has been for years. Would you mind doing that?
No, not at all, because that's actually, I was a biomedical engineer to start with, and since I've gotten my leukemia, I've done a tremendous amount of research on electromagnetic field, their toxicity, and the other side of it, electromagnetic medicine, where they use the frequencies, the more harmonious frequencies. And that's the irony of all this stuff, is that there's frequencies out there that are killing us, but there's other frequencies that we could produce our technologies with that could be harmonious to the animal kingdom, the plant kingdom, and ourselves. And yes, I would love to share that. You know, it's been a struggle for me for 10 years. They pronounced me dead 4 or 5 times. You know, I am alive, and I'm going to say part of it's due to modern medicine, but the other part is I do a tremendous amount of alternative treatment. I've been to some of the Mexican cancer treatment centers where they're doing bioimmune therapies, and they're decades, if not centuries, ahead of us because they're not limited by the FDA. And I'm a thriving person at this point, but it's been a struggle. And I'm telling your listening audience, they do not want to have leukemia. They are painful, and they're it's almost like dying from torture. It's a slow, painful death. And I don't want to describe it on the radio, but anyways, I'd be glad to call in tomorrow. Do you have a time you would suggest? Or?
Yeah, why don't you call in at the bottom of the first hour? So you're in Eastern time. Why don't you call in around 10:30 your time?
Okay, certainly. Well, I'd love to. Anything I can do to share.
And that number is 866-582-9933, 866-582-9933. And Bill, would you mind providing your telephone number when we take you off the air to our engineer? And I'd like to call you after this broadcast. You have a wealth of information. I think we should schedule some time for you to be on the air to talk about this in addition to tomorrow.
Absolutely. I certainly will. Okay. I appreciate the hard work you guys do, and keep it up, because there's not many people out there stating what's really going on, and it's scary at some level, at many levels.
I'm speechless. I'm absolutely speechless. You know, John Regan, I've heard his voice at times with a tear in his eye, and that's where I am right now. Bill, please give your full name and your telephone number to our engineer commercial break. Thank you so much, and we'll see you tomorrow. Captain John Regan, I'll be right back after these few short commercial announcements. Well, class, it's not just John Regan and me. There are a whole bunch of people, it seems, that are experiencing the same kinds of things that we are. And we're here connecting the dots with Fukushima 107. John, please continue.
Well, let's make the side trip to St. Louis. We had, before we do that, let me just say, that original article from the 14th of December, there's a link in there to the government website where you can get the PDF. It's a series of weekly reports. I believe it goes through April of 2011. And the part about the releasing of the spent fuel pools to the atmosphere is like in the first two or three pages. But when you go through the rest of the report, it talks about where Obama and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton were briefed on this. So they can't deny that they didn't know, because they did. Mm-hmm. Okay, St. Louis. There was a new study that was published late last month. It's a peer-reviewed study in the Journal of Environmental Radioactivity, showing strong evidence that radon gas and water coming from the Westlake landfill are responsible for the anomalous levels of a lead isotope that is created by radioactive decay, specifically from radon. And these are at very high levels, and a 2013 report from Westlake also had the largest estimated amount of thorium-230, which is a long-lived radiotoxic element, at levels more than any other nuclear weapons storage or disposal site in the U.S., and this is in the middle of a residential area just to the northwest of the St. Louis airport. A 2013 report from Westlake also had the largest estimated amount of thorium-230, which is a long-lived radiotoxic element, levels more than any other nuclear weapon storage or disposal site in the U.S., and this is in the middle of a residential area just to the northwest of the St. Louis airport. And shortly after that article was published, there's a piece written by Claire Burnish, "The Looming Environmental Disaster in Missouri That Nobody Is Talking About." Of course, we've been talking about it. And this one has been picked up by a number of web sources now. And it goes in and does talk about the study that I just discussed. And if you go down a little past halfway, it starts talking about the fire and the speed of the fire. And as of May 2013, Republic estimated the fire to be only 1,200 feet from the radioactive waste. The Missouri Attorney General, Coster, that same month said it was just 1,000 feet. So there's a bit of discrepancy, but all that means is a small difference in time. The EPA found evidence that waste extended 100 feet into the landfill, which could reduce the distance to as little as 900 feet. In June of 2013, the Missouri Department of Natural Resources commissioned a report where they found the fire had slowed from a rate of 3 feet per day to around 1 or 2 feet per day. Then in March 2014, a spokesperson for Republic said the rate had slowed to just 6 inches per month. But wait, there's more, and we'll get into that after the break.
Captain John Regan, I'll return after these commercial announcements. Captain John Regan's with us, and John, if a person had $150.93, he or she could buy extension cords at the Chinese factory outlet for $16.77 a piece. You get nine of them for $150.93. And if you plug them in end to end to end to end, that would stretch out about 900 feet. That's the distance we're talking about. If you wanted to know how long 900 feet is, that's about the length of a city block in Manhattan. So six city blocks end to end to end in Manhattan would be about a mile. We're talking about 900 feet. The fire that's raging underground is 900 feet from a nuclear dump site in Missouri near St. Louis that was created as a result of the atomic weapons that were unleashed by the United States on Nagasaki and Hiroshima in 1945. We did it. And we created nuclear waste, so we unleashed it on Japan and ourselves, right here in Missouri. And this was a big secret, and we are now exposing that this landfill is on fire adjacent to a nuclear waste dump right outside the city of St. Louis. Now, would you trust, if you lived in St. Louis, would you trust your government to tell you the truth? Because they haven't told the truth for over half a century. What do you think, John?
And let me just say how much, well, let's put that into sports terms. You know, 300 feet, 100 yards, that's the length of the football field, not including the end zones. So you're talking about three football field lengths without the end zones is the distance from where the fire is to where the nuclear waste is. And
John, let's put it in sports terms like this. Let's say you wanted to walk from your seat in the stadium to your car in the parking lot. That's probably what we're talking about.
That's probably even further than what we have.
This is a catastrophe. And we did it. We did it to ourselves through secrecy and non-disclosure. And why are we not releasing this? Well, it'd be about commerce, right? It'd be about protecting the tax base. It would be about revenue, tax revenue. That's what this is all about. And let's see, where does Budweiser come from? Is that St. Louis? Where does the water come from that is used in making Budweiser beer? Where does it come from? Is anybody concerned? Now, I have a feeling that if we all stopped drinking Budweiser, those of us who do, the impact might be significant enough to cause alarm at the revenue level to do the right thing about this fire, get the right scientists in there to prevent this from being a worse catastrophe. So who would want to drink radioactive beer? I'm not saying it is. I'm saying who would want to. Is there a possibility that the beer could be contaminated? I would think so. That might land me in court, what I just said. Let's bring it up.
I think given what we know now, I think we'd have to consider any food source, including organically grown on your own property, probably has some level of contamination from Fukushima.
Right. Right. I totally agree.
Now, before the break, I was talking about, this paragraph starts out, however, Sperling's report, and that report's a hyperlink to the Missouri Attorney General's website, claimed drastically accelerated figures, saying that the fire had spread north into the neck area of the site, and while the reaction in the south area sped along at 150 to 300 feet per month, or 5 to 10 feet per day. If it were to advance in the north at a similar rate, high temperatures could conceivably reach the radioactive waste area in 3 to 6 months, and that report came out in September. So if that report is correct, and, you know, it's hard to see exactly where the fire is underground. That means that any time from now through the end of March, that fire could reach the radiation. And even if it doesn't in that time frame, it's still heading that direction, and it's only a matter of time. And I pulled up another article. I'll get this on the link for next week, on uranium tailings. Basically, what we're talking about is the byproduct of uranium mining, and this is the radioactive junk that's left over. Uranium tailings contain over a dozen radioactive nuclides, the most important of these being thorium-230, radium-226, radon-222, otherwise known as radon gas, and isotopes of radon decay, including polonium-210. And I just might want to remind people, polonium is very toxic material that some nation states have used to assassinate people with. So it's really wonderful stuff we have right there in the middle of neighborhoods. And basically, it's a matter of time. When the fire hits that radiation, you know, whether it takes 3 months or whether it takes 3 years, if you have the same exclusion zone around that you have around other nuclear disasters, that would mean closing the St. Louis airport, closing I-70. I'm sure there's rail lines through there. There's, I think Boeing owns it now. What used to be the McDonnell Douglas fighter plant when I was at Scott Air Force Base is located right close by there at the St. Louis airport. You've got the Missouri River just before it reaches the Mississippi that would be in that exclusion area. So it is not an insignificant, you know, piece of real estate. Now, if you look at Fukushima, where it's located, it's on the coast, which, you know, in retrospect seems a little stupid. And it's, I guess you'd say anywhere in Japan has a pretty high population density, but not like Tokyo, which is really high population. And the exclusion zone around that is not in the middle of things. Here you're talking about St. Louis, the gateway to the West, the middle of the country. And, you know, it's just ugly. One of those things that the government has known about for years. They've managed to generate, you know, tons and tons of reports, but not get anything done to actually alleviate the situation.
You know, as we were talking about this, I'm wondering about, you know, where the water comes from for a lot of our food supply. You know, all the major brands, you know, how many of them use municipal water supply, the municipal water supply for their food production? And that's a real big concern. So I don't know how to answer that question, John. I was on the phone yesterday. We were talking about food with one of our instructors, and I was mentioning that, yeah, there doesn't seem to be much of a choice. We're going to have to grow our own. But okay, but what about, you know, what's coming out of the sky, the spraying? Well, we're going to have to grow it inside, which means, you know, LED lights or skylights or greenhouses or high hoop, high hoops for plastic covered high hoops for growing outside in raised bed gardens. That's what we're talking about. And I've talked to some people who, you know, don't want to come out on the other side. Okay, they just, you know, if it's this bad, just give up. I'm not in that camp. I'm not saying that's our instructors. I'm just saying I've talked to people who just don't want to deal with it. Well, I do want to deal with it, and I do want to come out on the other side. And I'll tell you what, though, it's going to be a rough ride. And those of us who do come out on the other side, heaven help those guys who caused the problem if we see them on the other side. They won't be welcome in many places. So, class, it's incumbent upon you to build your village. It's a tough road to hoe. And that's what I'm trying to do here in our little village. I'm trying to build a village with those who have skills. I'm not talking about freeloaders. I'm talking about people who can contribute to our survival of our village. And if you're an expert in setting up a foundation or a trust, we'd love to hear about that too. I mean, that's just one little threat that that we want to deal with. So we want to teach people how to set up a foundation, a trust, and build a school. And one school here, one school there, so schools all over the country in your village. And I'm not talking about a public school. I'm talking about people who actually really want to educate our young and our village. And we can do it privately. And it doesn't even have to cost anything. We can volunteer our time. That's what I tried to do in our little village here in Missouri. And I met with the county commissioners, and they laughed at me. We'll do it without them. We don't need them. Captain John Regan and I will be right back. What's coming up next, John?
We'll get back to talking about what's up at Fukushima now.
Okay. I can't wait. Captain John Regan is going to wipe that smile right off your face. I've seen him do it many times in person. Captain John Regan's with us, thefinancialstateoftheunion.com. Fukushima. John, Fukushima update.
Well, the radiation-contaminated water at Fukushima continues to increase, especially in the Reactor 1 building. TEPCO is trying to stop that. We've got reports of baby whales dying along the West Coast from unknown cause. At least the governments are doing tissue testing, whether or not they release that to us. we'll see. We've got an article where, and unfortunately my Japanese isn't good. It's the 10th largest city in Japan. It's 25 miles south of the reactors. And in the vacuum cleaner dust accumulated from this September, 5,600 becquerels per kilogram of cesium-134-137. So in a 2.2-pound amount of vacuum cleaner dust, you get 5,600 counts per minute, or 5,600 counts per second, I'm sorry, of cesium. And this article also has a link where in Tokyo, which is further away, they're getting 32 becquerels per kilogram, which is still a pretty good amount. We're also seeing suicides rise among the Fukushima disaster evacuees for a variety of reasons, some for health reasons, some for economic reasons. So the toll for the disaster continues to rise for more than just the radiological reasons. And I've got a couple of links on dosages. Don't think we have really a good amount of time to get into that. And I've got the latest on the USS Regan, which has become very pushed down in the news. And I've got several more links from earlier on and that describes what some of our young men and women went through on the Regan. A whole bunch of health problems are attributed to this, including cancer, tumors, brain defects, birth defects, early death, and a bunch of undiagnosed conditions. There's been several die, and of course they're not getting a whole lot of help from the government, and unfortunately saying they're not getting a whole lot of help from the mainstream media as well.
So, John, as I remember it, Fukushima had been, the reactors had started to melt down already. We sent the USS Ronald Reagan right outside of the disaster area as if we were going to do something. And I was thinking as this was happening, have we lost our minds? So we're going to send our young men, women, and warship over there to do what? And I guess it was for, we were going to provide disaster assistance. Is that correct?
Yes, that's part of it. And we also were going to provide some barges with fresh water to use on the reactors and the pools for the spent fuel. And I think they managed to get one in there, and then they started using salt water on all of that. So in addition to the Bigner effect, you've got the corrosion of the salt water. So it's a double whammy for all the equipment over there.
Very quickly, John Reagan, in your research, do you see any solution to the continuing contamination, or do you think this is going to continue for a while?
The quote is, the science and technology has not been invented yet.
Wow. Okay, class, this was today's broadcast was 2 hours, 106 and 107 in Fukushima. And it's really expanded to radiation and toxicity. And we'll have more. Captain John Reagan, thanks so much for being with us. Class, above all, honesty and integrity. What happens next is up to you.